Welcome back. We are in conversation with the top team of JP Morgan discussing all things macro and micro. Before I move to the next subject, I just wanted to finish this discussion we had on the farm loan waivers. Sajjid, you know, generally when you see states give out farm loan waivers, the agri capital formation as a percentage of GDP falls. This time, do you think it would be the same?
No, clearly farm loan waivers are a very suboptimal way to deal with the agrarian crisis. We've seen in the past leads to a lot of moral hazard, more pressure on banks. We're undergoing a deleveraging process. Here's the good news. I think there is a way to address this in a more efficient manner. We've actually moved in agriculture from the economics of scarcity to the economics of surpluses, right? And so the policy mindset has to change from scarcity to surpluses. What we should be doing is exporting some of these surpluses, have a systematic trade policy on exports and imports so farmers can plan and farmers can export. Look at the case of the US and China. China has slapped on tariffs on US agricultural imports, soya beans, right? Maize, wonderful opportunity for India to use that. If you can export it, you do two things. You create a remunerative price for farmers, and of course you boost foreign exchange earnings. So I think agriculture has changed rapidly to the point Kalpana was making. The transmission of price signals from consumer to farmer is much greater. The supply response is faster. The curve has become more elastic. Policy needs to respond to that. So I think we have to stop this, you know, race to the bottom, this competitive populism of farm loan waivers and higher support prices, and move to where the farmers have moved.
Yes, that's a long haul, but let's see how things pan out with new government.
But Latha, I'll just say one thing. Telangana, again, to the point Kalpana made, very interesting, right? You've had cash transfers per hectare. What has to happen is that cannot complement your existing subsidies. That must replace your subsidies, where you take away the leaky product subsidies and move to direct cash transfers on a per hectare basis.
No, we know, what we don't know is Telangana is more advanced in several administrative issues. So this Raya Bandhu cannot be replicated because that much of land records are not perfect in other states.
But that's where we have to head.
Issue for another day. Kalpana, I want to come back to this debt market issue. This September gloom and doom, besides global impulses, was actually triggered by ILNFS and this lack of faith in NBFCs. From your perch, what is your sense? Do you think there will not be another debt problem? Or do you think there could be other issues of bad assets from NBFCs, maybe real estate? How should we see the play out of this?
First of all, the problem is much smaller. I mean, if you look at the overall stress in the banking sector, I mean, this is total credit is 18%, of which housing is 9%. So you're really talking about a relatively small number. And I think the challenge for the NBFC is much more on the liability side than indiscriminate lending that's going to blow up into an asset quality issue. So I've seen worse in the NBFC sector, particularly in the mid-90s, so I think this will blow over. But Latha, I do want to call out that 2018, from perspective that I see, was a seminal year for India and M&A. We saw close to $100 billion worth of M&A in our country, which is indeed a very big number. A significant amount of that was driven by domestic purchase of distressed assets, but we saw a fair degree of cross-border activity as well. Indian companies, buying companies outside UPL, a case in point, significant FDI coming in through the Walmart purchase of Flipkart. So, I mean, I'm really pleased. So, yes, debt was a relatively smaller part of all investment banking business, but M&A was really the
Yes, and I think you're winding it up with the lip-smacking Horlicks as well, which perhaps is going to be a big deal for Hindustan Unilever. But, you know, I want to take that, debt market as well as the rural theme to you, Bharat. You know, one of the fears for consumption was that NBFCs were doing much of the incremental lending. Now they are contracting their balance sheet, some of them at least. So will consumption as a theme not fire?
See, I think what could happen is, you know, you could see a little bit of a tempering in consumption, particularly over a 6 month time frame, because as you rightly pointed out, the NBFCs, you know, will, you know, pull back a tad. But that said, I think, you know, if you look at the medium term picture, I think the banks will more than make up the gap, because I think the banks are getting more and more ready now to lend more. Loan growth is already at 15%, something we've not seen in the last 2 or 3 years.
15.6.
Exactly. And with credit cycle issues receding, I think give them 6 to 9 months and the banks will more than make up for, where the NBFCs are receding.
I can just add there, Latha, you will see different business models evolve. So the NBFCs will use their origination engine in terms of asset origination, and then you could as well sell bundles of those assets to banks who have a very strong liability franchise. So, you know, you'll have...
So this whole argument that a line of credit to NBFCs or MFs, those cries of extraordinary action not warranted anymore?
I don't believe they're warranted, because you will see that they themselves will work out areas of strength that can be leveraged off the other.
The Reserve Bank will be very happy if the government is listening to what you all are saying.
Okay, so since that issue is now out of the way, let's discuss the other point you brought up about a pickup in the private capex, because we were discussing with Neelkanth Mishra of Credit Suisse yesterday about how the gross fixed capital formation numbers indicated a surprising pickup in private corporate capex. What are your own thoughts on this? In the sense, is this a start of an upcycle? Where are we?
I think we've bottomed out. And I think, we're seeing some impulses, some growth impulses come along. I think, this is going to take some time to pan out. It'll take a little bit of time because, let's face it, we have an election coming up in 6 months. But, I mean, if I were to look beyond October 2019, I think, the ground is very fertile for a meaningful pickup in the investment cycle, because utilization levels have continuously been picking up. And we're already at, 76-78%. I think we'll be at 80% plus, and which is typically the time when corporates start thinking about CapEx. So I think, we've bottomed out. Give it another 6 to 8 months and we should see a meaningful
recovery. But when she asked you which stocks will take the Sensex to 11,500, you only said financials. Yeah. Which else?
I started with financials because, see, financials are very geared to a pickup in corporate capex. Because, loan growth is
always... But which else?
I mean, apart from that, you will see, I think, if you already see some stocks and sectors which actually are connected to the parts of the investment cycle that are doing well, are already, doing very well at this point in time. Let me give you a few examples. In all fairness, we're seeing a very decent pickup in activity in roads, in railways, in power transmission, in affordable housing in rural India. And, the areas that are catering to these segments, you see cement, you see commercial vehicles, you see tractors. I mean, growth rates in the low to mid-teens in all of them, and very good operating leverage. So I think, parts of that story are already panning out.
But the capital goods story as such has not played out for many years, right? I mean, it's been stagnant. So the L&Ts of the world, you think now are going to start to fire?
I think they will start firing. Again, you'll have to look at it over a 12 to 24 month time frame. Don't look at it on a 6 month time frame, because we all know that there is an election coming up, and 3 months before an election, not activity actually pulls off a little bit, and then you'll again have to wait for the new government to come in and start kickstarting things. But yes, on a 12 to 24 month basis, I think you'll see good results.
Okay, Sajjid, we're running out of time, but should we expect a rate cut? Will 2019 be that year?
I believe so. If you just look at the inflation trajectory in the first 6 months, inflation is consistently below 4%. I know a lot of this is food. Core inflation is elevated. My sense is the momentum of core inflation, given these domestic and global disinflationary forces, will also fall. I think it could be as early as February or could be April, but we are expecting some easing in the first half of 2019. Okay. I'll just take 10 seconds to say, on the CapEx cycle, if you look at the data, the slowdown the last few years has not been corporate investment. It's been household, which is a combination of residential real estate and the SME sector. When that sector becomes more economically viable, expect a more broad-based pickup in investment.
All right,
that's
you've given
key.
Us the headline for the day and for the year, perhaps. All of you saying that 2019 looks like a very promising year. You should expect a capex uptick and financials to benefit by it. You could expect a rate cut as well, which could boost the growth. And Kalpana saying that 2018 already has been a year of great deals. And perhaps we are entering 2019 with a lot of promise, earnings growth, as well as perhaps valuations keeping to the 2018 levels. Great promise, or at least looking out for a very promising 2019 from the JP Morgan Brains Trust. We wrap up this edition of the JP Morgan's Brains Trust. Thanks for watching.